take a man on the street. This man has $10 million in debt, yet he is a financial winner. How can that possibly be true? Well, by the end of the video, I think you're going to get the greatest debt mindset lesson that you've ever had in your life, and it's gonna help you build wealth for yourself. Hi, I'm Keith Weinhold. This is Get Rich Education. I think in order to understand how this guy on the street is a financial winner, is to use a couple sports analogies. The man that's thrown more interceptions than anyone ever is Brett Favre, Super Bowl champion, Green Bay Packers, Hall of Famer, maybe even upper echelon Hall of Famer. So how in the heck is he a Hall of Famer if he threw so many interceptions? Because his team had faith in putting him on the field, knowing that he also gave them the best chance to win. That's why he had so many losses, because he had so many chances. The baseball pitcher that has thrown more losses, lost more games for his team than any other pitcher in the history of Major League Baseball, his name is Cy Young, one of the greatest pitchers of all time. Cy Young also won more games than any pitcher in the history of Major League Baseball. Even though he pitched over 100 years ago, he still got that record with 511 wins. So how does he have more losses than anyone else? Again, he got so many chances. He had such a long and storied career that means, incidentally, he also tended to lose more games, even though he's the greatest winner of all time. In fact, not only is Cy Young a Hall of Famer and the greatest winner, but still today the award that they give the most outstanding pitcher in baseball is called the Cy Young Award. Yeah, the guy with more losses than anyone ever. So let's get back to this guy on the street with $10 million in debt. I didn't tell you his entire financial picture. The amount of debt on his net worth statement is that $10 million mentioned, but his assets are $25 million. Well, net worth is assets, $25 million, minus debts, $10 million, equals $15 million is his net worth, a substantially higher net worth than average. That's why I called him a financial winner. See, just like Favre and Cy Young got a lot of opportunities, understand that in order for this man to even have been able to obtain $10 million in debt, that banks and lenders must have found him pretty credit worthy. Just to even get that much risk, you're not going to have a W-2 job where you make $65,000. So to even get in that position, that $10 million in debt is actually a wealth marker. That's how you need to look at it. Now, in real estate, you know how I love to talk about getting in a lot of debt in order to create wealth for yourself. Now, that's really counterintuitive. It's only a certain kind of debt that you want. You have good debt when you own real estate because there's collateral underlying that real estate that you borrowed against, and the bank is going to make sure that you have that. You also shouldn't even buy a property in most instances unless the monthly rent income exceeds the monthly expenses, including that mortgage. Well, that way your debt is serviced for you by the tenant. So it's about thinking differently. This is what we're talking about here. But as soon as you tell someone how they need to actually think differently and put it into practice, that's how they get a little bit scared. But you know that to have an outsized financial impact on the world, you need to do unusual things. So if you have a fear of anything, it shouldn't be good debt. It's actually a fear of being normal. It's the same kind of fear that I had to overcome myself at one point. The good news is debt is how you can control more. If you just own your own home and one rental single family home, it's pretty difficult to build substantial wealth while you're actually young enough to enjoy it. So you can control more when you borrow more responsibly and when you take on more loans. Okay, whoa. This might sound really revolutionary to you if this is new to you. And it's always a prudent question for you to ask. What is the risk associated with obtaining a lot of this good debt, whatever you want to call it, for real estate? You want to buy property in a market that has a reasonable expectation that there's going to be economic stability in that job market, a metro area where there's a pretty good diversification of income and industry. And you can still pick wrong, but it's pretty easy to see these things. Maybe if you would have bought property in 1980s Detroit when the population was declining rapidly or something like that. Well, yeah, that is a risk. That is about the worst case scenario because you might not have tenants that would be able to pay that rent. But these things over the long term are generally somewhat predictable. In real estate, it's an epiphany to some. You've got to remember that the market is even more important than the property itself. But still, what if the real estate market drops and the value of the property that you bought goes down in value? Isn't that a risk? Wouldn't that diminish the net worth that I just talked about earlier? Yes, it potentially could. But remember, you've only bought a property if the rent income exceed all of the monthly expenses, the mortgage and the operating expenses. So therefore, if a property that you bought for a certain price, say $300,000, temporarily goes down in value to $250K, that's like a 16-17% drop. That's really huge. But you know what? Even if it's temporarily suppressed in value, as long as you have those rent incomes coming in order to pay the mortgage because you've chosen a good market, you're going to be able to service that debt, so it shouldn't matter so much that it's temporarily suppressed in value. You just wouldn't have to sell it in that condition. Why would you even want to sell it when you're getting rent income that exceed the expenses, so you're still making a profit each month? It's still paying you every month, even if it is temporarily suppressed in value. And if you're new to real estate, rental amounts, they really don't fluctuate much. They're pretty stable. They're pretty steady here, where prices tend to bounce around somewhat more than those more stable rents do. So what you're doing is you're buying right in the first place. I actually did a podcast episode where I talk about this. I called it the debt decamillionaire. Not just a millionaire, but a decamillionaire having $10 million in debt. The debt to decamillionaire. It was Get Rich Education Podcast episode 260, where I talk about this more. Understand this. If you have just a 3% rate of inflation, the debt decamillionaire actually has a $300,000 tailwind to his investing. This guy on the street. That's because at $10 million in debt and a 3% inflation rate, you only need to pay back the bank in inflation-adjusted dollars, not real nominal dollars. So therefore, after 1 year, rather than owing the bank $10 million in debt, you only owe them $9.7 million in inflation-adjusted debt and $9.4 million after year two, and so on. And that is really just background noise in addition to all the other ways that a real estate investor makes out. That's how you can be a profiteer. Inflation transfers wealth from lenders to borrowers. In this environment, you more than likely want to be a borrower more so than a lender. And you know what? Everything that I just said right there, that's true even if interest rates are as high as, say, 8%. And we know that mortgage interest rates are less than half that right now, really making this a slam dunk if you can find a sound property in the right market. That's key. And you know, it's a big world with a lot of information. A lot of people want to go out there though, and rather than getting information, because that shakes people up, you're getting information now. Instead, people want to go get affirmation, for example, maybe with how they can retire the debt on their primary residence faster. Well, that's usually not the best and highest use of your investing dollar. In fact, the return from home equity is always zero. I explained that in my other media. I know that's a real epiphany for a lot of people the first time that they hear it. So your goal might actually be something like $10 million in debt because you've got underlying collateral. It's good debt when every bit of that is outsourced to tenants, or whenever your debt's interest rate is lower than the rate of inflation, which it might also be these days. When your debt's interest rate is lower than the rate of inflation, the dollars that you pay the bank back with are being debased faster than interest can even accrue on you. So get in love with good debt, the right kind of debt. It definitely sounds counterintuitive. We're not talking about credit card debt or unsecured debt or high interest rate debt or anything like that here. This is a way where rather than living below your means, you can expand your means. You know, people often say that I want to be frugal when they think of financial betterment, but I don't think you really want to be frugal if you really think that through and you understand the opportunities that are out there. Rather than saying I want to be frugal, I think what most people would really rather say is I want to live well But a lot of people just don't know about a vehicle for living well, like prudent real estate investing for cash flow. In order to be like Brett Favre or Cy Young, you can't live below your means. You've got to expand your means. Hey, if you happen to like this video and you find it paradigm shifting, because this one really does challenge your thinking somewhat, go ahead and put a like on this video. That helps give me feedback that you do like what you're seeing here. A comment does as well. I know this one might really challenge your beliefs. It might be a bit more difficult for you to feel it out. So feel free, if you have any question related to this, to put your question in the comments, and I will effort my very best to reply to it myself. But there's no such thing as going into debt with likes. You're not gonna get into like debt if you give too many of them out. So I appreciate the like that you have on this video. This is a kind of thing that wealthy people do. Why would you have so much money tied up in a home when you can borrow against that home or against that piece of real estate for such low mortgage interest rates? In fact, Mark Zuckerberg, the Facebook founder, mega wealthy, when it was time for he and his wife to buy their home, even though he could have paid cash for it many times over, he got a low interest rate mortgage because he understands things like this. That's why the person on the street with $10 million in debt is a financial winner. It's about gaining that debt mindset. I hope you've enjoyed this debt mindset lesson. I'm Keith Weinhold. You can listen to me every Monday on the Get Rich Education podcast. You can listen at any time with the Get Rich Education app. I'll continue to create more material here for you on the Get Rich Education YouTube channel. Thanks so much for stopping by.
People say live below your means.
Below your means.
And Bassick deals.
That's like Bonds bunting. That's like Brady retiring after college. Or Beyonce quitting after Destiny's Child. That's like flying all the way to the moon without walking around on it. That would be like Enter the Wu-Tang, Three Chambers. Or the perfect triple axel without sticking it. Expand your means.